languages in this festival are national or ethnic languages like Korean, Russian or Urdu, which had no definite beginning and have changed haphazardly over many centuries. But there's another kind of language, sometimes called an artificial language, and the most famous one is Esperanto, but I'm actually going to talk about a number of them. Now, even though the word artificial is often used, I think the word artificial is unnecessarily pejorative, because in fact, in some ways, all languages are artificial. There's nothing that actually says that this thing or this concept has to be called this word, or these words have to be constructed in a particular way. So really, what people refer to as natural languages are just languages whose origin is sort of lost in the mists of time. So, constructed languages, sometimes referred to as conlangs, because some people, like me, are a bit lazy, are fascinating in their own right. And a disclaimer, I do speak one particular conlang, Esperanto, as my badge here says, but it doesn't mean I'm actually going to show why Esperanto is the best possible constructed language. But I will be including Esperanto in the talk briefly, although I will also be doing a separate session on Esperanto tomorrow at Bondi Pavilion, and Richard is actually going to be doing a session on Esperanto just after this one. So apart from sampling 17 different conlangs, I want to address some questions, such as, why construct a language? Is a conlang a real language? How many conlangs are there? And when was the first conlang invented? Okay, well, let's go for the last question first. When was the first conlang invented? We actually don't know, but a very early one was called, was called lingua ignota, which literally means in Latin, an unknown language. It's from the 12th century by an abbess called Hildegard von Bingen, I believe was actually Saint, so Saint Hildegard von Bingen. Based heavily on Latin, and in itself, it's similar to a conlang in its systemized grammar. And I just have five words. I don't even have a complete sentence in it. And here's, how about if I move over here? Does that make it difficult for you, Richard? There you go. Then people can actually see the screen without me being in front of it. How's that? Okay, so there's five words in lingua ignota. All right. Now, why construct a language was another question. In some cases, it's to try to overcome the curse of this. Does anyone know what this is? The Tower of Babel, you know, which is the story from the Hebrew Bible, the Old Testament, that said that mankind was getting pretty cocky, and they thought, there's nothing we can't do, let's build this tower up to the heavens, and God didn't like this, so he decided to confound their languages, and the tower tumbled down, and suddenly everyone discovered they couldn't make themselves understood to other people. So that's the curse of the Tower of Babel. And many conlangs were created with the idea that if we could just get back to this one perfect language, which some people actually believe was a proto-Hebrew, in fact some people believe was actually the Hebrew of the Old Testament, was the language, then everything would be okay. Many conlangs of the 17th and 18th century were philosophically based to create a perfect medium for discourse. For example, one with not a very catchy name, Real Character and Philosophical Language, comes from the name of the treatise by John Wilkins in 1668, an essay towards real character and philosophical language. It was intended mainly for scholars, but also for diplomats, travellers, merchants. The term real character was a family of symbols corresponding to a classification scheme, kind of like Roget's Thesaurus. You're familiar with Roget's Thesaurus that bad poets use to find a word or, for a concept that isn't the same word that they've already used once or twice before. But in fact, Roget invented the thesaurus as a philosophical thing to systematize all possible human thought. So in fact, if you look at the original Roget's Thesaurus, you'll discover at the beginning things are divided into material and immaterial, and the material is divided into this and that. So it's kind of a taxonomy, a hierarchy of everything that you could possibly want to talk about. But people since then have used the thesaurus as a way of, as an aid to write. Some people refer to it as a backwards dictionary, because you start with the meaning and then you find the words that match it rather than the other way around. Anyway, so this was based on a tree of the universe, things material and immaterial. Here's just one part of that tree. Category 18, beasts, which divides into live birthing and egg laying. Live birthing beasts divide into hollow-footed, cloven-footed, and clawed. Clawed divides into rapacious and non-rapacious. Rapacious divides into cat kind, roundish headed, and dog kind, oblong headed. And the dog kind divides into European and exotic. European divides into terrestrial and amphibious. Terrestrial divides into greater kind and lesser kind. Greater kind divides into dog, which is docile, and wolf, which is wild. So, in this language, this hierarchy of ideas, a dog is a docile, oblong-headed, rapacious, clawed, live-birthing beast. Okay, how does that turn into the language? Well, here are the symbols. Beast, okay, category 18, beast, oblong-headed. Now, in fact, the language doesn't actually use every single part of the categories because just for the sake of some simplicity anyway. Greater kind, oblong-headed is that addition to the symbol, that bent line. Subcategory 1, greater kind, and then you add a little circle to show a minimal opposition. So that's how you find the wolf. So the trouble is, there are obviously many, many ways of categorizing the universe. Imagine that you were going to create a categorization system. Do you think you'd do it in exactly the same way as Wilkins? Probably not. So that's the symbol for wolf, and it's interesting that, with a bit of imagination, I suppose you could say it looks a bit like a wolf. How do you speak this language? Okay, beast is Z, oblong headed is T, greater kind is A, so Zeta is a dog, and Zetas is a wolf. Now, can you see another disadvantage with this system, apart from kind of arbitrariness? This is a criticism of this language from someone called Albert Werard. Words expressing closely related ideas have almost the same form, differing perhaps by their last letter only. So it would be exceedingly difficult to remember all these minute distinctions, and confusion would arise in rapid reading and particularly in conversation. But perhaps this wouldn't have bothered Wilkins, because the purpose of his language was to be a pure algebra of thought. Okay, so that leads us to possible purposes of a con language. We've already had to be a perfect language, an algebra of thought. Another one is to be an international language used by as many people as possible. So therefore, ease of learning outweighs this idea of being perfect. It should be good, but not so perfect that it becomes unworkable. Another idea is for it to be a work of art, or perhaps for a fictional world, and we'll encounter some examples of that later, or perhaps an interesting experiment. Some languages were invented not really to be spoken in conversation, but just to see what would happen if people were made to communicate or tried to communicate in a particular kind of way. Would it affect the actual way that they think? And also, conlangs differ in their origin, and most books that I've read on this split conlangs into a priori and a posteriori. In other words, a priori is Wilkins' philosophical language, so the words for things bear no resemblance to any supposed or so-called natural language, whereas a posteriori languages have grammar and vocabulary derived from ethnic languages. You also get mixed. You get some conlangs which have a bit of both in them. So a priori is Wilkins. Also related to this distinction and difference of purpose is the distinction between ideology and pragmatism. An ideological approach says that language should be as perfect as possible. The pragmatic approach, it says that it should be perfect enough, but not at the expense of usability. Okay, next language is sol res sol, which is I find very interesting by a Frenchman, Francois Soudray, and the words were made up of 1 to 5 syllables or notes. So notes of the scale. So each may be one of 7 basic phonemes, which can also be accented or lengthened. So that parts of speech are derived from verbs by lengthening one of the syllables. And so you have do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, si. So as you can see, the name of the language is constructed in sol, re, sol. Words beginning with sol have a meaning related to, hang on, let me just go back again. It's supposed to actually make the sound. Okay. It goes dun dun dun. So you can actually play it on the piano. You don't have to actually say sol re sol. You can just hum it if you like. So they're related to arts and sciences, whereas sol sol. So that's sol sol re do, which means a headache. So, like other constructed languages with an a priori vocabulary, sol re sol was hard to learn and based on an idiosyncratic way of categorizing the universe. But perhaps there was another problem, and I'll illustrate that with a video of a play. And that is that after a while it just becomes a little bit ridiculous. Maybe it's because they're terribly bad actors. But it's perhaps hard to, you know, be terribly meaningful when you're and so on. Okay, universal blot. It's an a posteriori language, the vocab derived from existing European languages. It was much admired later by language creators, but it wasn't particularly successful in its time. And here's a sample. Men signori, sende e vos un grammatique e un verbibil de un nuov blot, nomen universal blot. I probably don't have to actually translate that for you. You can kind of get the gist of it if you know some English and a bit of Romance languages. Okay. Volapük is particularly important in for Esperantists because it was really the first conlang to have taken off, and it was the immediate predecessor for Esperanto by a German priest called Johann Martin Schleyer, and the vocabulary is actually mostly, even though he was German, it was mostly from English with some German and French. So theoretically it was an a posteriori language. However, because of Schleyer's insistence that basic morphemes had to have this this pattern, consonant, vowel, consonant, for example, vol. And that certain sounds, for example, the sound of er, are eliminated because they would be difficult to pronounce for Asian people, for example. Many words were unrecognizable. So for example, vol is world, and puk is speak or language, so volapük means world language. The grammar is very complex. For example, every verb can be conjugated in 1,584 ways.
Oh my God.
But it actually became quite famous, perhaps surprisingly so. By the end of the 1880s, there were about 200 volapük societies and clubs around the world, and 25 volapük journals. Even people who didn't learn it at least knew about it. President Cleveland's wife named her dog Volapük, for example, and the craze was big enough to be mocked in local papers such as the Milwaukee Sentinel. A charming young student of Groot once tried to acquire Volapük, but it sounded so bad that a friend called her name and she quit it in less than a mook. Okay, and here's a sample. If you should travel in Europe, you will hear many languages. Here's a video of someone speaking Volapük a bit better than I did. Poetry reading. So the complex grammar and other difficulties led to recommendations for its improvement. And this is the death knell of conlangs, is people saying, oh, it's pretty good, but it should be improved in this way or that way, and so on. And the reason why it was the death knell for the language is that they were all rejected by Martin Schleyer. In fact, he insisted on retaining total control. The result was a splintering into, here are just some of the offshoots of Volapük. Its popularity declined as a result, and also because of the rise of Esperanto by Ludwig Zamenhof in 1887. And my talk tomorrow and Richard's, just after this talk, will give a bit more detail, but I'll summarise here. Esperanto, literally in Esperanto means hoper, one who hopes. It was after the pseudonym Dr. Esperanto that Zamenhof gave. So he actually called it lingvo internacia, but Esperanto is a little bit catchier. The vocab, English, Romance languages, Germanic languages, Slavic languages, even a bit of Greek. The grammar is basically agglutinative, like Japanese, rather than inflectional. So the Esperanto word eksterlandano, ekster means outside of, land means land, and arno means member of. So it's someone who belongs to an outside land. Japanese, I believe, I hope there's no one here that actually speaks Japanese, because I'm probably wrong here, but I've been told that wei wa ren, means exactly the same thing. In an inflectional language is one where parts of the word, when words change their grammatical role, verb to a noun or become pluralized or something like that, you change the morpheme, the root itself, such as foot and feet, for example, in English. It would be handy if all you had to do was add an S, and then it would be, that part of it at least would be agglutinative, but English and a lot of other languages are inflectional. Unlike Schleyer and his Volapük, Zamenhof gave control of Esperanto to its community of speakers. He actually supported some suggested changes, but decided to submit them to a vote. The result was, let's keep the language as it is, not necessarily because the language was perfect, but because major changes would have been too disruptive at that point. Yet there have been breakaways, most notably, like that. Keep forgetting to press the button. Most notably, Edo from 1907. However, even it had breakaways. How many speakers of Esperanto is a question that you often hear? Well, it's very hard to say, because what do you actually mean by speak? And there was a Finnish linguist, Jorko Lindstedt, gave the following estimates in 1996, based on some surveys that he did in multiple countries. There's about 1,000 people, roughly, who actually have Esperanto as their native language. So they're children of parents whose common language was Esperanto. There are about 10,000 people who you would say spoke it fluently. There are about 100,000 who use it actively. And I probably put myself in that circle rather than influently, but Richard, I think, would be in the one of the 10,000. Okay, there's about 1 million who can use it, understand a large amount passively, and there are probably around 10 million people who have studied it at one time. So the question is, which circle do you actually use to answer the question, how many speakers of Esperanto are there? As a comparison, in the year 2000, there are about 100 to 200 speakers of Edo worldwide. And their world congresses, which apparently they still do have, or at least as of a few years ago, are very intimate affairs. Esperanto is one of 71 languages supported by Google Translate, and I have a video here, which I'm going to actually skip, of a broadcast from El Popolo Chinio, so it's a Chinese a TV program that uses Esperanto. Latino Cineflexione is one of a number of projects to revive Latin but make it simpler, so it's Latin without flexions. So here's a sample, which I'm not going to read out, but you can, again, like Universal Glot, you can probably get the gist of it. If you know some Romance roots and so on. Interlingua is a similar kind of thing, not so specifically based in Latin, not by one person, but by a committee of people, the International Auxiliary Language Association, 1951. It's definitely a posteriori language based on similar principles to Universal Glot and many like it, and it actually achieved a moderate degree of success because of its association with scientific research. And here's a sample. Peace, in common with liberty, requires constant devotion and incessant vigilance. So you can kind of passively understand it, but then that's only half of the language task. You know, if you want people to actually write it and speak in it, then you need to actually make sure that what you're saying makes sense. Okay, Logland's a very interesting example by James Cook Brown, 1960, who was a sociologist and a science fiction author. It was originally designed as a tool for linguistic research, investigating the Sapir-Whorf hypothesis, which, very simply, it's the principle of linguistic relativity. Language precedes thought. So it's not as though you have thoughts and then you try and find the words for it, but the thoughts that you are capable of depend on the words and the language that you have available. So he decided, all right, let's create a language where there's no possibility for ambiguity, as there is in English. For example, if we say, the lady hit the man with an umbrella, then what does that mean? The lady had an umbrella and hit the man, or the man had the umbrella and the lady hit him? Okay, there's no way to know just with the language. Loglan, which you probably worked out by now, means logical language, doesn't allow that. So there are no words with multiple meanings. For example, the English word left. He was the last one left. He left the room. He's the one on the left. None of that is possible. So here's a bit of log land, and there's the there's the translation of it, and you can see how logical it is in the much former now. So, you know, a long time ago, three somethings X were small sisters, said the dormouse. This apparently comes from Alice Through the Looking Glass, I think, who began to speak very quick, becomingly, and were named, and here's a list, Elsie, Lacey, and Tilly. At the same time, three somethings X, who will now be referred to as Sorm, I don't know why, inhabited the down part of one waterhole. So, not exactly the perfect language to tell your... Yeah, so here's the more natural translation of it. Not really the kind of language you would really tell children's stories in, I don't imagine. Okay, Lojban was invented because Loglan, the copyright of Loglan, was held by James Cook Brown. People wanted to tinker with it and he wouldn't let them, so they said, okay, we'll create our own. So, hence Lojban. Those people familiar with software development would refer to this as an open source language. So it has a marker for figurative speech. It's like, you know, adding a smiley face icon at the end of your Facebook page, Facebook post, I suppose. And here's an example. True, false, that's true, and you may realise that comes from Esperanto. You is a speaker of English language, okay? And here's, in other words, do you speak English? Unfortunately, I don't have a translation for that. Now, here's another one that's similar to that, in that it's an experimental language called Laadan by Suzette Hayden Elgin, and it's a feminist language. It contains words to make unambiguous statements that include how one feels about what one is saying. It's designed to counter the male-centered language's limitations on women, who are forced to respond, "I know I said that, but I meant this." Most Laadan sentences have three particles, or words, or particles. The first is the sentence type. It's either a statement, a question, or a request. The second is the tense, past, present, future, or hypothetical. And the last is evidence for statements, or wa, known because it was actually perceived. We, known because it's self-evident. If perceived in a dream, assumed true because it came from a trusted source, assumed false because the source is distrusted, imagined or invented, hypothetical, and the validity is unknown. Okay, so let's construct a sentence in Laadan. So let's have a statement in the past involving work, woman, and it's perceived directly. So that means the woman worked, and I know because I witnessed it. If we wanted to make a question, we do exactly the same, bar eril ha with, which means, did the woman work? And you don't need to add this last particle because it's a question. You don't actually know what the source is. And here's a request in the present, say, speak you. It's please speak laden f. Okay, so there's the accusative ending there. Toki Pona. I believe you're a bit of a fan of Toki Pona, Richard.
Speak a tiny bit.
Well, there's only really a tiny bit to speak, isn't there?
Yeah, true.
By a Canadian translator and linguist, a minimalist language focuses on simple concepts that are relatively universal among cultures, inspired by Taoist philosophy. It's not designed as an international auxiliary language, which is probably why a number of Esperantists have also fiddled around with it, you know, tried it out. It has 14 phonemes, which are listed there, and 5 vowels, including 5 vowels. 123 root words. So basically 123 words in the dictionary. Toki is language, talking, to talk, speech, to speak.
Communication, verbal, to chat. Pona is good, goodness, simplicity, simple, positive, benevolent, ideal, nice, correct, right, and to repair. So no diphthongs, long vowels, consonant clusters, or tone. The roots are generally from English, pidgin, top pidgin, Finnish, and so on, including Esperanto. And so it's more democratic, perhaps, than Esperanto, but that doesn't necessarily make it easier to pick up. If you happen to speak one of those languages, maybe you're not in that much, it's not that much better for you. Here's a sample, a very famous passage. Anyone want to make a guess? It's what just about every conlang gets.
The Bible quote.
Yes, and it's in particular, it's the Lord's Prayer. Bliss symbolics. Okay, we really have to, I think I've got about 5 minutes left. Was done to help kids in the Ontario Crippled Children's Centre having cerebral palsy communicate. So this is interesting because it's a graphical language. You know, a bit like what people think hieroglyphics was. Several hundred basic symbols can be combined to generate new symbols. The symbols don't correspond to sound, so it's not a spoken language. And here's an example. I want to go to the cinema. So I, person, plus the number one, first person, want, so it's the heart, which is feeling, fire, and the verb indicator above, to go, the leg, and the verb indicator, and cinema is a house with pictures that move. Okay, now a few fictional languages before we finish. Quenya and Sindarin from Tolkien, from the Middle-earth trilogy. The Lord of the Rings from the mid-1950s. The interesting thing is these were invented first, long before, as you can see, he invented it from about 1950. The books were came out in the 1950s. So Tolkien actually said that the languages were his secret vice. He did them kind of in secret, and then he thought, well, if I write some books, then people will think that's the reason, it'll have a purpose for the language. And here's a little bit. Klingon. I'm sure a lot of people were waiting for me to get onto Klingon by Mark Ockrand, and it had a definite purpose right from the beginning. It was done for the movie Star Trek. So not the TV series, because even though there were supposed words in Klingon spoken then, they weren't real, whereas for the movie, the producers decided, well, let's actually hire a linguist and we'll get a real language created. So they got him to do it. It was designed to sound alien, and the vocabulary was centered on spacecraft and warfare, so it's perhaps a little bit hard to say darling I love you in Klingon. And here's a bit of Klingon. Speak it rather aggressively. Na'vi is from a more recent film, Avatar from 2009, but the language had been in from 2005. It's designed to be learnable and pronounceable. Doesn't sound like a real word, is it, pronounceable? Anyway, by the actors. And all elements are from human languages, but the combination is unique. Sorry, I should have had a louder speaker there. But that is actually the creator of it, Paul Frommer, speaking Na'vi. It's interesting, although there's a Klingon word for thank you, most Klingon speakers just say mudge, which means good. Dothraki, any Game of Thrones fans here? Dothraki is the language from Game of Thrones, and by another linguist. Has a huge audience, so perhaps more people have heard Dothraki than a lot of other languages inspired by Russian, Armenian, Estonian, Inuk, Titut, and Swahili. Okay, whatever you say. All right, how many conlangs are there? It's impossible to say. This book, In the Land of Invented Languages by Arika Ockrent, she thought she'd be able to count how many languages there were. She got to 500 for her book and then she just gave up after that. And I think now she has this web page. I think she does actually add to that when she discovers more. But the book in itself is very interesting. So conlangs differ according to their purpose, their ongoing development, their origin, their vocabulary, and if it's an a posteriori vocabulary, it's based on either one language or multiple languages, and the complexity is either minimalist or complex, and conlang users differ according to their philosophical approach, whether ideological or pragmatic. Is a conlang a real language? Unfortunately, I'm not going to answer that question because we've run out of time. But here that's the book that I can highly recommend by Arika Ockrent. If you want to be a little bit more academic, there's this one by Umberto Eco, which I'm about halfway through, The Search for the Perfect Language. If you're an Esperantist, you might like this one. En la serĉado de la mondolingvo aŭ interlingvistiko por ĉiuj, in the search of the world language or interlinguistics for everyone. And interlinguistics is the word for the study of constructed languages. So thank you in various conlangs.